Okay, and I'm very eager to introduce our next speaker. Let me just say before I do that, if you have questions along the way, as you're listening to Dr. Frieden's talk, if you could just put them, wave the card around and someone will come by and pick them up. So we'll be ready to go when we have questions and answers. So we are very fortunate today to have as our next speaker, Tom Frieden, whose full bio is in your binder. But a few words about Tom. Dr. Frieden is the director for the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention and the administrator for the Agency for Toxic Substances and Disease Registry. As you all know, his immediate prior job was Commissioner of Health in New York City, where he had numerous distinctions that are well known, dramatically reduced the rate of teen smoking, pushed through a number of changes in terms of the elimination of trans fats from restaurants and many other things which are in his full bio. What may not be known to you about Tom is that he spent more of his life on explicitly infectious disease response than he did even at New York City Department of Health. And so these issues are quite obviously dear to him. and he's also had the unique distinction of running a local response before then becoming in charge of a federal agency response. Two critical posts in the nation's response to H1N1. I know he's already done many great things for CDC since his arrival last summer, and we are very eager to hear his views today. Thank you so much for being here.
Thanks very much, and one risk of going after such a great panel is that it'll be a situation analogous to those who say, well, everything I've wanted to say has been said already, but not by me, so I'll give my talk now. And what I'd like to do is just share with you some reflections on what happened, what went well, what didn't. It's great to see new and old friends here. Marcy Layton, who knows that this outbreak, as do all of them, began for us in New York City on a Friday afternoon. And the challenges were substantial. The New York City Health Department has a very substantial epidemiologic, laboratory, outreach, managerial capacity, and yet this was an enormously challenging experience. We had to pull people from throughout the department. We had to activate our system. We had to pull people into work. We had to get our school nurses trained in collecting nasopharyngeal specimens. We had to upgrade our lab, our information systems. We had to have a very active communication effort. I'll continue talking until they figure out how to get the slides up. I think there is among some a perception that this was, in a sense, a false alarm, and that's a very misguided perception. This was a serious outbreak. It killed at least five times more children and adults under the age of 65 as a usual flu season. It caused more than 60 million cases of illness. It caused more than 250,000 hospitalizations, and it caused pretty intense social and economic disruption. We minimized that disruption, and we minimized the illness through all of the technologies available to us. And that was done through the effort of literally tens of thousands of public health workers around the country working effectively. It was done at a time when millions of Americans visited emergency departments for influenza-like illness. It was done at a time when we were able to work intensively with partners throughout the country to improve our ability to monitor the epidemic so that the distribute network, which was put up rapidly, expanded rapidly, was able to ultimately track emergency department visits in a third of all of the emergency departments in the US, monitoring ultimately 38 million emergency department visits, 100,000 a day, more than 100,000 a day. There were hundreds of thousands of diagnostic tests, and the CDC lab disseminated about 2.5 million test the kits with the availability to test 2.5 million specimens. There were more than 4,000 H1N1 isolates that underwent some level of genetic sequencing. Critically important, we tracked intensively, is it mutating, is it changing, is it becoming more virulent, is it becoming resistant to antivirals, is it becoming antigenically changing such that the vaccine match would be less good. Critically important, and the laboratory is often overlooked in public health, but is core to our ability to succeed. We disseminated more than $1.4 billion to state and local health departments to communicate, to test, to monitor epidemiology, and to treat and to vaccinate. And there were hundreds of millions of website views at flu.gov and CDC's websites. We ultimately had more than 325,000 shipments to more than 70,000 providers of H1N1 vaccine. More than 80 million Americans were vaccinated, including more pregnant women and more school children than in a usual flu season, despite the concerns about a new and some feared unproven vaccine. We distributed more than 12 million antiviral regimens, including pediatric regimens, to fill a gap in supply in the commercial market. We distributed surgical masks and respirators, and we investigated thousands of adverse events documenting that there was no signal which would suggest an increased risk of a serious adverse event from this. And within the first really month or so of the vaccination program starting, we could say definitively that the likelihood of having a Guillain-Barré-like problem was essentially nil. As a result, we identified the pandemic quickly. We determined how to prevent spread and protect against risk of protect those at risk, at most risk. We improved treatment to prevent hospitalization and death, and we vaccinated rapidly once vaccination became available. And I think that essentially is the goal, and taking those steps one by one, starting with surveillance and epidemiologic and laboratory work. The virus was detected because of a US-Mexico border project using an experimental point-of-care diagnostic device, which was in place because of a partnership between CDC and BARDA for biologic development. It had been established really in part to do exactly this, to identify new strains of influenza developing. And it's an important example of the kind of technological advance that allows us to detect things more rapidly. A lot didn't go well, and I'll get there, don't worry. There was a very effective public-private partnership which allowed us to use a five-target PCR test for rapid detection of H1N1. And although this was somewhat seamless to many of us, myself included, at health departments around the time, it's really a remarkable tribute to the planning of those who went before. We were able to promptly share the viral sequences, reagents, and virus strains to facilitate the medical and manufacturing response. And the result of that was the availability of tests shipped within 2 weeks of virus identification to state and local health departments to be able to determine what the local epidemiology was, and within days thereafter to 150 countries around the world. And within weeks thereafter, the seed strains provided to the manufacturers to begin developing the vaccine. Public health capacity is crucial to countermeasure application, and I think is all too often neglected. It may not be as sexy as some of the new technologies, but it is core to our ability to succeed. And because of the investments over the past few years, there was a stronger epidemiologic, clinical, and virological surveillance system that could be strengthened. Also a stronger response system that could be strengthened. The preparedness dollars had strengthened the plans and linkages, logistics, and communications capacity of state and local health departments. I want to recognize Rich Besser, who ran the Preparedness Center, and you'll be hearing from later, who both guided those dollars to sensible investments and then led CDC at the first months of this pandemic. we were able to deploy antivirals, including using the emergency use authorization mechanism to get more than 1,000 courses to critically ill people in hospital for intravenous use. We formulated vaccine recommendations with ACIP in July 2009 that you could debate, but probably were right, even with the wonder of 2020 hindsight. We were able to successfully build on the Vaccines for Children's Fund program, which enabled us to, it wasn't that interesting, don't worry. But just to catch up, let me mention, this is the five target PCR, that what we ultimately sent out, CDC, 2.5 million tests to all states and 150 countries. It was a partnership between a partner in industry, which had a platform, the CDC, which had the virological expertise, and the FDA, which facilitated the rapid licensure, or EAU, of this. And this is essentially the timeline from the first cases, and I'll get back to that, to recognition, diagnostic kit shipment, and vaccine seed strain shipment. A very rapid response. That first bullet of late February, early March, undoubtedly H1N1 was circulating for weeks or months before it became apparent in Mexico. And we were anticipating that pandemic would emerge in South Asia, Southeast Asia, and it didn't. It emerged here in North America. And this really emphasizes the critical importance of global disease detection, of ensuring that all over the world we have systems to detect problems when they emerge and to respond, characterize them, and respond rapidly. And the Vaccines for Children's Fund had about 45,000 doctors signed up. We were able to increase to over 100,000 number of doctors who signed up and use that infrastructure, including really remarkable logistics. 300,000 shipments, bringing together multiple different, it's not just one vaccine, as those of you who are involved in this know, it was many different types of vaccine, different characteristics, different need for ancillary supplies, the supplies not needing a cold chain, the vaccine needing a cold chain, being shipped out. It was a huge effort, and the reason you didn't hear about it is that it went well, and that's the nature of public health. Paramivir, available under EUA, on the website, over 1,000 treatment courses distributed. Real challenges here in how do you determine when there are adverse events to something which is being used for people who are critically ill and at risk of death, and EUA not being a great way to determine whether something works, so the need to determine what we need to do and make it happen. Vaccine, rapidly developed, tested, and licensed vaccine from five different manufacturers. Those of us who lived through the 93, 94 challenges with the flu vaccine thought, you know, with five, we shouldn't have one out of two having problems, but clearly we were wrong in that they were all using the same seed strains, which had the same problems, and I'll get to that in a minute. Clinical trials done rapidly and excellently by NIH determined that a single dose was effective. Good news. School-based mass vaccination efforts ultimately vaccinating about a third of kids, and in some states, two-thirds of kids. Really remarkable and very important infrastructure going forward. And an unprecedented public-private program with, again, more than 80 million people vaccinated, along with effective and expanded safety and effectiveness monitoring. We could always get better information. This is the shipped to sites, and more than 70,000 sites shipped to. The collaboration was very important between public and private sectors. I'll show you a map with retail pharmacies in a bit. Timely communication, absolutely essential. And Rich and Ann and others really did a superb job of this early on in the pandemic and throughout, with frequent briefings, web information that was available, PSAs, and perhaps not immediately apparent, a communication strategy that was adjusted based on an analysis and understanding of what the public perceptions and misperceptions and understandings and misunderstandings were, so that we think about evidence-based public health programming, and this was, to a great extent, evidence-based communications work, not just assuming what people know, don't know, think, don't think, but trying to understand that and tailor the messages. And an excellent collaboration with and support for and from local, state, national, and global in terms of all of this. This is the number of provider agreements and what you see here, pre-launch and then launch. So really by the end of October, you had gotten essentially everyone on VFC signed up, and then ultimately over 100,000 physicians signed up. That is an infrastructure that remains in place for state and local health departments to improve adult vaccination, something that we do very poorly with in the US. These are the pharmacy chain locations, an excellent partnership there. Now, moving forward, there are important lessons that need to be learned. The first, we have to strengthen both our own and particularly global surveillance systems and laboratory capacity. Surveillance systems includes the ability to analyze and respond to information. It's not just a lab, it's not just one person, but it's a system. And we need to do that really throughout the world. We need a global laboratory network that's able to detect and respond to infectious disease challenges. Since the earthquake in Haiti, we've had staff on the ground, literally on the ground in Haiti, sleeping in, at the floor of the national laboratory in Haiti, getting diagnostic kits up, getting the ability to diagnose leptospirosis locally, typhoid locally, other problems locally, so that we can respond effectively locally. That type of laboratory work is core for effective responses. Improve vaccine. Now, a lot has been made, and with reason, of our dependence on egg-based vaccine technologies, but I think there are other aspects of vaccine improvement that are important to highlight. One is the production of effective seed strains. This is a technology that could be improved substantially. We could produce them faster, more reliably, more consistently high yield, with some work probably over the next few years. That would not be a game changer, but it could cut 2 to 4 weeks off vaccine production. 2 to 4 weeks would have made a big difference here in terms of vaccine uptake. Similarly, 1 to 2 months earlier detection in Mexico would have made a huge difference in terms of ability to get vaccine out before disease was widespread. Similarly, potency testing is done by an incredibly arcane method that also is time-consuming, and in fact was one of the key reasons why there were very off-kilter projections of how much vaccine was available. The companies did not know until they had the potency testing reagents. There was a delay in getting the reagents to them, or it took a long time, and once it was there, they had a lot less vaccine than they thought they did. And critically, vaccine delivery systems. All the vaccine in the world isn't going to work if you can't deliver it. And clearly, some things went well. School-based vaccination, we made progress. Vaccination for pregnant women, we made progress. Risk groups, we made limited progress, I think. How do you reach people at highest risk and ensure that they get the vaccine? Our colleagues in the UK said, well, that's really straightforward. We just tapped into the electronic health record, those with the underlying conditions, and sent them appointments to come in for their vaccine. What do you do there? So clearly emphasizing our need to have a healthcare system that has an information system that works, that emphasizes prevention, that's coordinated, and it covers those at highest risk, and all of those at risk. In terms of pregnant women, you know, there was a lot of attention to this very unfortunate situation that you had pregnant women waiting on long lines to get vaccinated. I think the backstory behind that was you had health departments pleading with obstetricians to take the vaccine in their clinic so that wouldn't happen, and in many areas, obstetricians unwilling to do so for reasons that are understandable. It doesn't pay, it's complicated, it's cumbersome, and it requires a lot of administrative work to do vaccination. That doesn't mean it shouldn't be done, and an increasing number of obstetricians are vaccinating. That's important for seasonal flu and something that we can harvest from this experience. But it illustrates, I think, some of the difficulties of doing this in a healthcare system that doesn't cover everyone and doesn't emphasize prevention. Engaging the media and new media to get the message out, critically important. Interacting effectively with the healthcare system, something that we can only be as effective as our collaboration between public health and healthcare, something that we need to continue to work on. And engaging state, federal, and local government in a unified response. State and local public health departments are going to need improved epidemiologic and laboratory capacity. They face critical funding shortages in the years to come. They're not going to change anytime soon. We need to continue to plan, drill, and exercise. We need to continue to build on management, logistics, and communication capacity. We need to strengthen the linkages with healthcare systems and improve integration across sectors. We also need a laboratory capacity that can adapt to the unexpected with a skilled workforce, good assays, reagents, a network, a regulatory requirements that are sensible but effective, high throughput capacity, the ability to look for drug resistance, characterize agents, and the ability to work as needed within high containment labs. Better countermeasures are needed, but also better countermeasure delivery, intelligence about presence and modifications, weaponization, storage and deployment logistics, evidence-based recommendations, and algorithms for use. It's not enough to have a countermeasure. We have to know when to give it, how to give it, where to give it. Practical recommendations for application. And one of the things that we did during the vaccination campaign was to rapidly share best practices between one area and another. What's working well? What didn't work well? So we don't have to go down that blind alley. How do we address specific populations, especially children, for whom we have limited evidence and ways to reach for many countermeasures? And there are ethical and regulatory issues that are important. And there are some countermeasures for which there will be limited commercial interest. Fundamentally, we should take public health impact or health impact to guide our response, to determine what's needed based on maximum health protection, to decide what to make or be ready to make, to ensure that it gets to the people in need using everyday systems that can be reinforced and scaled up. If we invest in systems that we're only going to use in an emergency, we're going to have problems. If we invest in strengthening the system that can be scaled up for an emergency, we're much more likely to succeed. And I'll give you an example of that. The VFC system worked, and it worked wonderfully, to get over 100 million doses of vaccine out very quickly, very widely, with state ownership of who it would go to. That worked. Getting antiviral drugs out was much more difficult because we didn't have a pathway. We didn't have a system to get that out. I think still most of the demand for antiviral use wasn't necessarily for the people at highest risk, and we know that the people at highest risk had a much higher likelihood of getting antivirals. So the antiviral distribution system or antiviral availability worked here, but the distribution system was certainly rough and it was challenging. Thank you for your interest in this, and I look forward to any suggestions, questions, comments, or complaints that you have.
Okay, if you have any questions on cards, just put your hand up and we'll get them to you. All right, I guess the first question, a human interest question, was, what was the most surprising thing, change in going from the health department in New York to CDC? Especially as it relates to H1N1, but you can, you know.
Well, I was very fortunate in that we had been through an enormous amount of the challenges of H1N1 in New York City. So I had a sense of what it was like. We had, Marcy can tell you more, but it was really challenging. I mean, we had literally hundreds of schools with large clusters or outbreaks that we were monitoring on a daily basis. We had emergency departments setting up tents to deal with the overflow of patients. We had businesses closing. We had antivirals being ported. We had rumors flying. We had laboratories being overwhelmed and yet people making inappropriate use of laboratory tests, both not testing those they needed to test who were critically ill so we could find out whether the virus was changing, and testing those who they shouldn't have been testing and making inappropriate determinations to treat or not treat based on testing. So I had a sense of what was needed and what was going right and wrong in the community. And I guess the challenge at CDC and the importance is to have really a single public health enterprise between local, state, and federal governments, so that there is a real understanding at the federal level of what the needs, challenges, and strengths are at the local level, and so that at the local level there's an appreciation that there's a value to understanding from a technical basis what's happening from CDC or from other areas of learning from best practices to be able to implement. I think that the difference really was the intensity of the H1N1 outbreak in New York City versus the incredible heterogeneity of the outbreak across the U.S., both of the virus and of the response. It's a big country out there, and the virus behaved differently, same virus, behaved differently in different places, and the healthcare system and the public health system behaved differently in different places. Not necessarily always better or worse, but different. And for each of those places, we need to figure out the optimal way to respond.
Okay, the next question I have is, if the H1N1 vaccine had been adjuvanted, there would have been no vaccine shortage. How many excess deaths might we have prevented if we had chosen that route? And other countries did. Can we talk more about choices made between the U.S. and other countries?
I think that was a right choice, actually. There's a lot of vaccine hesitancy and vaccine suspicion in the U.S. And I think adding an experimental substance, which in fact did cause some adverse events in other countries, would have been a very serious problem. In the same way, if we had had, we don't, but if we'd had a new vaccine technology, unproven, that could have produced a vaccine faster, it would have been a challenge to think of whether people wanted to receive it at this time. And maybe you could make an argument that there should have been an option for people who wanted to get adjuvanted vaccine to get it, but I think the challenges there and the bleeding or contamination of suspicion about an experimental vaccine would have been very harmful, I think, to the overall effort.
A question about surveillance. Has CDC been able to take concrete steps to improve surveillance in Mexico and other countries in Latin America following H1N1?
We are very committed to doing so. There's a lot of interest. We've provided laboratory technology, but I think there is a real interest in global health system strengthening. Sometimes that's a concept. Where it gets very concrete is laboratories, making sure that laboratories exist and are effective around the world. And I think much more needs to be done in that regard.
And a question about the science going on during the response. Will there be a move toward rapid release of sequence information to NCBI so that the world research community can work on things like virulence and resistance and pathogenicity?
I had thought that was happening. I think that
is it happening?
Already.
Excellent. Check that box.
And in fact, I have to just give our laboratory credit, the CDC laboratory and other laboratories around the country credit for just terrific work. Not only surge capacity, but creative, thoughtful work such that when new mutations were reported in the press and the literature, they rapidly could characterize the three-dimensional confirmation of those mutations, the epidemiologic linkages, the laboratory issues that would lead to them being a concern or not. So that we could know when things were problems and not.
Do you want to say anything about the discussions about mandatory vaccination that were going on in the fall?
No.
Okay. That's why I asked you it that way.
Okay.
I can wait you
I
out.
There's you asked. There is an issue. There's an ethical issue. The evidence is pretty overwhelming that patients cared for by unvaccinated healthcare workers are more likely to get sick. I think that brings an ethical issue into the healthcare sector, that healthcare workers who don't have a medical or religious contraindication have an ethical responsibility to protect their patients and should be vaccinated. Now, what's the best way to get there is another question. You certainly don't want to put additional burden on healthcare workers. You don't want them having to pay out of pocket or lose work or lose time. But there are lots of benefits to their being healthier, they're not bringing disease home to their families, and fundamentally them ensuring that they're not making their patients sick.
A question about the role of private businesses in the private sector in response. Is there more that the private sector could do, or are there ways that they can contribute that we didn't explore necessarily in the fall?
There was tremendous willingness and eagerness to collaborate, to participate, to be constructive, and it's greatly appreciated. There's lots of parts of the private sector, medical, non-medical. Clearly, the chain pharmacy program was very important and an important thing to do going forward. Large employers can be quite important in getting messages out. One of the things that we were quite concerned about, and four secretaries wrote to small businesses about, the many people don't have sick leave. So here was CDC saying, stay home if you're sick. Here we are in the middle of a severe recession with people struggling to make ends meet who are not going to get paid if they do what CDC tells them to do. And we pleaded with companies to have a generous leave, to allow telecommuting, to not penalize people for protecting their communities.
One last question about communication and public perceptions. A couple of people have talked about the difficulty in public misperceptions over the course of the pandemic. Is there any particular public misperception that you thought was kind of the most important to clear up, or that we need to work on going forward, something that is just not the case?
I think perhaps the biggest challenge is that flu is complicated. Flu is hard to understand. So not so much a misperception, but you know, we kind of went guardrail to guardrail of you're exaggerating, it's not such a big problem, to, oh my goodness, look what's happening, why didn't you do more? And I think we tried to just be very upfront from day one throughout the public health enterprise of saying, this is what we know, this is how we know it, this is what we don't know, and this is how we're going to try to find out. But the public generally isn't very tolerant of uncertainty. And to be able to try to convey to people that this is what's known, and we can say that confidently. And beyond that, it's conjecture. And often we heard people from academia or elsewhere reporting conjectures or stating conjectures as if they were certainties. And that's unfortunate. I think the public is best served if we're open and honest about what we know, what we don't, what we're relatively certain about, and what we're making maybe an educated guess or maybe not such an educated guess about.
Well, on that note, thank you so much, Dr. Frieden. Would you join me in thanking Dr. Frieden? Thank you for your service.